So the sermon today is going to focus on eternity. And I'm actually going to take a risk today and possibly make you uncomfortable. Now, for those of you who have a hard time standing, I'm going to invite you to raise your hands when I ask the others to stand. All right, you ready? So there's going to be a little bit of standing right at the beginning of the sermon where you're going to, you know, make yourself conspicuous. All right, you ready for that? You can handle that, right?
Yes. Yes.
Thank you. Got three voices that are ready to go along with me. In Romans 4 this week, in our soaping readings, we read these words. It was talking about Abraham and the story of Abraham in the scripture. And it says, it was recorded for our benefit too, assuring us that God will also count us as righteous if we believe in him, the one who raised Jesus, our Lord, from the dead. He was handed over to die because of our sins, and he was raised to life to make us right with God. So here's the question today. If you believe that Jesus was crucified and rose again so that your sins would be forgiven, I want you to stand up. Now I want you to remember that you're convinced of that. I want you to be thinking about that as we journey through the sermon. Because a part of what we're talking about today is that the assurance of eternity that becomes ours because we're made right with God can impact us every day. Please be seated. So I know that you've probably never heard this verse before, but let me just read you this verse from the Gospel of John that a lot of football players like to wear on their faces. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. This idea from Romans that you all believe in, that says that because of the death and resurrection of Jesus, you are made right with God, extends into this verse in John that says, your eternity is taken care of. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Can you say with me, my eternity is taken care of? We have that assurance. We claim that assurance. That's often not hard for us in the church to believe. And I'll tell you that one of the most comforting, joyful moments that I get every now and then as a pastor is when I'm at the bedside of one of our people who knows they're about to die. And they look at me with peace because of the assurance of knowing where they're going. We had a conversation with Marilyn's mom when we were in LA a couple of weekends ago. She lives in a nursing home community, and a lot of times, too often, the people that she dines with, the people that have become her friends, pass away. And there's almost this sense as they begin to get older and as they begin to be able to do less and less that they're ready to go home. They're ready to be with Jesus. They're ready for their eternity in heaven to begin. Sometimes when that gets prolonged, they wonder what God is waiting for because they're looking forward to the life to come. We had a wonderful saint at our church in Cupertino who had long before that actually been a secretary to Marilyn's father when he was a pastor in North Hollywood. She was 104, I think, before she passed away, and she was ready to be with Jesus at 84. And for the last 10 years especially, she was asking the question of her pastors, why can't I go be with Jesus? So I know and I've seen the evidence of, especially in that most critical moment of this power that faith has to give us peace and hope in the midst of death. Because our eternity is locked in, because Jesus paid the price, because Jesus' resurrection gives us the evidence that God has power even over death, we are a people that have hope for eternity. Now, just to be sure about that, we have this letter of Paul to the church in Thessalonica. It's an interesting passage. Let's listen to it again, even though Glenn read it beautifully. And now, dear brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to the believers who have died. Anybody here ever gone through grief? Paul is writing to the church in Thessalonica. He's saying to the believers there, some who have died of natural causes, some who have been murdered, killed for their faith. And he says, we want you to know what has happened to those who have died. And why do we want you to know? So that you will not grieve like people who have no hope. We want you to grieve like people who have hope, that hope can take just a little bit of the edge off the loss that grief is a journey through. For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised again, we also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him the believers who have died. See, there's a hope here that goes beyond the fact that they're okay in heaven. And the hope is, we'll see them again. We'll be reunited. We'll be together again. That's a powerful hope. Now, I'll be honest with you. The scripture gets confusing as it relates to this eternity question in this respect. It sounds like in this verse, that as Jesus comes back, those who have died, who have been with him in heaven, are coming back with him. But then the text goes on and it talks about he will call first those who have died and they will rise first, and then those who are alive will join him. It sounds like they're waiting in the grave for him. And we don't know. It's not clear. The Bible really isn't clear. It kind of speaks in both places. But one thing that it assures us is this: there's no pain, there's no tears, there's no impatience in heaven, in death. Then Paul writes, then together with them, we who are still alive and remain on earth will be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Then we will be with the Lord forever. This assurance that I asked you to stand up for is an assurance that says we'll never be separated from God. Romans, when Paul wrote to the Romans, he put it this way: nothing can ever separate us from the love of God that is ours in Christ Jesus our Lord. When I get discouraged, I need to remember that. When I get tired, I need to remember that. When I see those whom I love struggling and suffering, I need to remember that. Because it's easy in the midst of the struggle to feel like you're the only one. It's easy in the midst of fatigue and tiredness, and especially of pain, to think, why me? As if nobody else is there. And there's power in the compassion of our Lord, who says, I am with you, and nothing can separate you from me. We are with him forever. Now, here's where the whole standing thing comes in. That section of scripture ends with this admonition. So encourage each other with these words. You see, when we're down and when we're confused and when we're in pain, when we kind of forget that God is there with us, that He loves us each and every day, all the time, through everything, we need encouragement from others to remind us. Now, a part of me thinks that you're hearing me say, well, actually, a part of me thinks you're not hearing me say anything. A part of me thinks you've just kind of tuned out. It's like, okay, yeah, Pastor, this is baseline Christianity. We didn't need to come to church to hear this. We know this stuff. But a part of me thinks that when we're in that hard, hard place, that's the time when we need discouragement. But what I want to suggest to you is that there's probably moments, many moments, in every single day when you need to be reminded that you are loved. When you need to be reminded that you are a child of God, a person in the covenant relationship with God who will not let you go. Marilyn has a table out there letting you know that the Tia Zaza event is coming soon. We chose the name Tia Zaza for this mission ministry we have with Hope School in Madagascar. And what many of you may not know is that Tia Zaza really means love the children. Because in our ministry to them, we want to our gifts to be an expression of our love for them. And all the time we're reminded that God loves them. But there are days, and there are moments and days, when we need to be reminded that we are children of God and that God loves us. It happens when we lose a swim meet. It happens, Abby's not here so I can't pick on her, but I was gonna, when you land on your back when you're trying to dive, you can tell her later, Dad got it, okay, good. It happens when a friend dies. It happens when business is not going as well as we would have hoped. And when we're trying to figure out how to pay the bills, it happens when we get cut from the team. It happens when our closest relationships are fractured and broken and weakening. In those moments, we need to remember that we're loved. Because when we don't, we get sad, we get angry, we get defensive, we get controlling, we can get mean-spirited because we're trying to protect ourselves. Our hurt is manifesting itself in irritability. Anybody remember that? You see, I'm actually making this suggestion. I know this sounds crazy because eternity is this huge, huge thing. And I'm making this suggestion. I'm suggesting that that huge, huge thing says something to your irritability. Now, isn't that insane? I mean, irritability is such this small thing, but Pastor Jim, I mean, really, seriously? Encourage each other with these words. Let me rephrase it. Be encouraged with these words. Allow the promise of God for eternity to give you security and strength and courage to meet today. Encourage each other with these words. Eternity, by definition, doesn't start tomorrow. Eternity, by definition, doesn't start when you're 104. When does eternity start? Well, actually, not even now. It's been going on forever. You're already in the midst of eternity, and because your eternity is secure. You're in it now. Now, I recognize there's a not yetness to that. I recognize we look forward to that day where there will be no more sorrow, no more pain, no more tears. So instead, we live in the security of eternity and the anticipation of the fullness that is to come. Now, most of the kids aren't in the room, so if I mention the holiday that's coming up after Thanksgiving, even before Thanksgiving, I know I'm going to get somebody mad at me because the music's already started to play in the stores and I've already heard complaints. But do you ever live with anticipation? Are you ever looking forward to the meeting or the Christmas celebration or the reunion or the party? Does it sometimes put a little bit of dance in your step as you know that you're looking forward to what is to come? How can we be the Advent Christians? How can we be Desert Hope? Desert is wilderness. And hope comes from the assurance of eternity, the knowledge of God's love for us. You see, you stood before, and I just want you to stand tall. I want you to stand strong. I want you to have a look of confidence in your face and have it in your voice. Because your eternity is secure, you can be hope in the desert times. And you can be hopeful for each other, and you can be hopeful for the church, and you can be hopeful for your family members, and you can be hopeful for the city, because you are standing on our very first value. Worship is the starting point. We have hope because it depends on who God is. Our confidence is not in our faith. Our confidence in the one who is ever faithful. Our confidence is not in our love or our assurance. Our confidence is in His love and His assurance given to us. And so we can respond to the world with hope and with assurance and with a word of encouragement, because we know that we are loved. And we know that those to whom we are talking are loved by God. And so we are the church that brings hope. We are the church that reminds people that they are loved by God. I'll throw this in just in case you missed it. No matter what? Even if they have purple in their hair. Even if they have tattoos. Even if they have body piercings. Even if they listen to and even sing rap music. Even if they're unemployed, even if they have a record, even if they have an Obama bumper sticker on their car. We need to be reminded that every single person we see is loved by God. We need to be reminded that most people we see need to hear from us an encouraging word that reminds them that they are loved by God, that they do not need to be weighed down by guilt for past offenses. Because they too are offered a Savior who died so that their sins would be forgiven and who was raised, assuring them of the hope of eternity. You are the church, the hands and feet of God, to remind the world God loved them so much that he gave his only Son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but have eternal life. You are Desert Hope, and we're asking you to remind every one of our children that they are loved. If they're crying, if they're loud, if they're stubborn, if they're throwing a tantrum. And I'm going to embarrass her since she came back into the room. Stand up with me, please. This is Abby. She's been around from the beginning of Desert Hope and before. When we were hiring Pastor Braden, and we had a gathering of people on that team with potential youth people, we asked Abby this question: what do you like about Desert Hope? And she gave us and me the biggest compliment I've ever received in my life as a pastor, as a minister of any kind. She said, when I come to Desert Hope, I know I'm loved. That is such an awesome thing. Remember that when you go to the meet, okay? When people meet us, when people see us, when people talk to us about this congregation, let's encourage them and make sure that they know that they're loved. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.